This edition of Rehit Pixels comes to you from Germany. Yes, I've left the UK for a little bit. So it's fair to say that this country has a bit of a checkered history. That's quite an understatement. What excites me about it, though, when it comes to retro gaming, is the Cold War era of things. You know, everything is now modern and capitalist. But back in the 80s and 70s, 60s, 50s, this place was divided and the eastern part was under Soviet influence, which meant a lot of poverty and austerity, really. Imagine that. Technology was quite far behind, and when it came to the 80s, West Germany got to enjoy all the modern home computing of like Nintendo, Amstrad and Commodore. Commodore was very popular over here. On the east side, they had very inferior technology and they're trying to play catch up, and their stuff is kind of really primitive, but also interesting at the same time. And this is all exhibited at the Computerspiel Museum in Berlin. I'm going to take a look at that now.
Probably the best €9 you'll ever spend in Berlin, Computerspiel Museum is located on Karl Marx Alley. And that road name gives you some obvious foreshadowing for what I'll be showing you inside.
Quick interruption. My visit to Berlin took place in January 2020, nearly 3 years ago. Yes, that's all before Brexit, the pandemic, and the atrocities being committed by Vladimir Putin. I did mean to get round to editing this video much, much earlier, but in lockdown, other things took priority. I had so much work on. The centrepiece of this video is my historic look at European gaming under oppression from a brutal regime, which, given current world events, has reinforced a sinister background to it all. Obviously, I never planned this. Importantly, not much has changed at the Computerspiel Museum, although the standard admission price has gone up by €1. Shocking. Anyway, do give him a visit, and it's on with the video.
You got a gaming room with all your fancy retro hardware lit up in IKEA cubes. Well, this chronological collection is a jaw-dropper, especially as it features the greatest computer ever made. And this laughable pretender to the throne. This is like a retro gaming YouTuber studio to the power of 10. And dotted around the place are a few random artifacts, like the VC4000, a late 1970s game console created by a hearing aid manufacturer in West Germany. When I got back to Blighty, I emulated this. It was like a budget Atari 2600, if you can really imagine such a thing. This is Leapfrog, based on... oh, you know. In summary, it's Frogger delivered via teletext. There's nothing like an exciting boxing match, and this is nothing like an exciting boxing match. I do have to come clean, this is a two-player game that I'm playing on my own, so there's no action from my opponent. And the reason I'm playing on my own is that I've been messing around on a VC4000 emulator this evening, so it's no wonder I've got no friends. This is Grand Prix, one of the games from the Car Races cartridge. I'm clearly struggling with the controls, and so let's return to Computerspiel Museum. Going back further, this time into East Germany's history, here is the Picodat toy learning computer from 1969. Essentially, you play with logic gates and circuits to turn lights on and off. I was curious to see how East Germans took to home computing in the 80s, and this is it. My introduction to computers was in 1987 with the ZX Spectrum 1-8K Plus 2. Behind the Iron Curtain, if you're very lucky and well off by East German standards, you might have got your hands on one of the KC85 series of computers. Now this here is the KC85/3, out in 1986. I'm emulating its successor, the snappily named KC85/4, which surfaced in 1988. As I'm not a native German speaker, my pronunciation of a few words could be slightly out, or could even be massively wrong. You have to put up with my attempts anyway. Here we have Borgschlacht, which translates to castle battle, and it's devoid of any frills. This is Soccerban, and I think you know the score here. It's not going to win any awards for animation, but it is adequate. Here's Cheesebuder, which means shooting gallery, and it's a rip-off of arcade game Carnival from Sega. I can't see any bullets I've shot, which might be the emulator's fault, or it might just be down to how badly this game was programmed. There's another East German take on Carnival, which I'll show you later on, elsewhere in Computer Spiel Museum. The KC85 series of microcomputers were based on Z80 chips, but ran at half the speed of the ZX Spectrum. Unsurprisingly, Tetris emerged on this platform. After all, it's one of the world's most prolific games. Unfortunately, this is the most Spartan version of the game I've ever played. Meanwhile, on the western side of the Berlin Wall, Computer Spiel Museum invites you into the bedrooms of gamers from the past. In replica format, obviously, doing the real thing would involve a crowbar. Anyway, this is the 1970s. Get a load of that Atari 2600, sitting in a room that's coloured in various shades of beige and brown. In the next room, and indeed the next decade, the various shades of beige and brown here are due to this popular home computer. The hardware, along with its on-screen colour palette, are dominated by hues of magnolia, tea, coffee. Oh, Commodore 64, why are you so beige? It's the 80s, meant to be the age of neon, and you're just dressed in taupe. The other 80s bedroom is home to the NES, the console of choice for Germany during this decade. And of course, the 90s, where the first PlayStation established a gaming epoch of mature themes, by which I mean urban desolation in Silent Hill, the bone-chilling horror of Resident Evil, and the something-something of Crash Bandicoot. Now, there are a lot of things in the rest of this museum. I'm not going to detail every square centimetre, so here's a whistle-stop look at a few of those things. This is a joystick. Look at the joystick. It's a joystick. A 1980s magazine called Match, but it's about computer games and not English football leagues. This is how the Fairchild Channel F hit the West German market, rebranded as Sabre Video Play. They've rebadged it, you fool! This literally translates to kids in traffic. I kid you not. Now we're talking. These are Amiga Scene demos from the 90s, and they've got that one in front 242 in it. Points deducted for not showcasing Jesus on ease, though. A lovely depiction of the time gamers got together to oppose a vile fascist in Second Life. Always good to humiliate the far right. This is a crazy mashup of some of the most familiar retro games in the world. It's somewhat interactive and takes you through, if I've got this right, Super Mario Bros., Spy Hunter, Pac-Man, Pang, The Legend of Zelda, and Space Invaders. And this is a save space. Right, there are opportunities to play video games in one of two arcades. This one sits in a sort of 1970s-1980s time span. For this time period of gaming, I'm a huge fan. Sorry. Anyway, it's all on free play, so what have they got? The retro gaming cliché that is Space Invaders, which still holds up today. Tetris, the game that has more official conversions across gaming systems than anything else, according to the Guinness Book of Records. Scramble. Never really got this. This missile command cabinet also lets you play Centipede and Millipede. Move over, Crossy Road. This is the true OG. It's Frogger. Lovely to see asteroids. Probably the most modern game in this particular arcade dates back to 1989. This is Badlands, which is basically a post-apocalyptic super sprint, where the cars can be armed to blast each other. I wasn't very good at this here in Computer Spiel Museum, but when I emulated it at home, I did loads better. Perhaps it's something to do with the control system. The arcade cabinet gives you steering wheels, but I've done a lot better using a USB joypad in MAME, as you can see. This is a highly underrated game. I've never been into Super Sprint, or the somewhat better alternative to that, which is Ivan Iron Man Stewart's Super Off-Road. However, when you get to blast at your opponents, which gives you a pretty damn good advantage, I feel it's a brilliant game concept. Now, I do feel the western side of 1980s arcade gaming is more than adequately represented here, but how did things go down in East Germany back in the day? Well, there's a certain arcade cabinet I need to cover, the Polyplay. Literally the only arcade machine officially allowed in the whole of East Germany. There aren't many of them left in the world, but this museum has one. Meanwhile, there's still a lot of Western gaming to cover. These are gaming milestones. Apparently. The other free-play arcade in Computerspiel Museum takes us to the late 80s and a bit of the 90s with a few exceptions. A lot of this is centred around motor racing, the bulk of the games being from Sega. And why not? Germany has a strong reputation in the automotive industry and is well respected in motor racing culture. While I was on this holiday in Deutschland, I hired a car just to go on the Autobahn and it terrified me. Still, there is room for a few classics. Never liked this though, even though it's one of the early instigators of video gaming. Super Sidekicks 2, Paperboy, Vindicators and Xevious probably aren't in anybody's top 10 of must-play arcade games, but that's fine, these have some unusual appeal. Although Vindicators is a terrible tank-flavoured take on Gauntlet that doesn't deserve anything more than a minute of gameplay. Okay, we're going back to the eastern side of the wall because this museum has a Polyplay cabinet. About 2,000 were manufactured, and each of them gave you 8 games, which were incredibly basic, even by the arcade standards of 1985. Those of you well into video gaming history will drop your jaws at this. All the way from 1971, this is the first commercially released video game. It's Computer Space. The museum understandably doesn't want you to touch it, and it doesn't appear to be functioning, but look at it in all its retro-futuristic glory. Of course, we have nods to gaming characters from more modern times. Then there's this bizarre corner that seems dedicated to food-related games.
And now for your delight, look at all the games on the Polyplay.
This is Deer Hunt. And any semblance of artificial intelligence has been replaced by drunken movement. What is remarkable is that the East German authorities allowed any depiction of shooting at all. They tended to outlaw scenes of violence, but I suppose the plucky struggle of the proletariat to acquire some fresh venison is a hearty aspiration the communist DDR wants you to embrace. In your face, West Germany! Here's a little animated interlude from behind the Iron Curtain. Hasse und Wolf, that's Hare and Wolf to you and me, were the two main stars of Soviet Russia's popular animation, a cartoon called Well Just You Wait. As you can see, it's pretty much their equivalent of Tom and Jerry, or maybe Roadrunner. And it's a lot better than Worker and Parasite. Why, with all these zany pranks, a video game based on these characters must be full of endless larks. Oh. This looks, like a completely original video game idea, right? How have they packed so much in, man? Again, the enemy artificial intelligence is just to randomly wander about. What's particularly galling about this ripoff is that when you eat the power pills, carrots, the ghosts, walls, are still a hazard to you. This skiing game is called Downhill for a very obvious reason. Although it seems primitive, there's a kind of demented genius behind this. If you don't move left or right, you speed up really, really fast, just like in real life. I don't know why this takes place on a black background when it could and should be white, but I have to give this props for at least getting the principle of speed right for a slalom run. As it emanated from a Soviet-influenced state, I think we can refer to this as Boris Goes Skiing. Sorry, not sorry. We're return to more cartoon fun, and this time you might even recognise the subterranean hero of this animation, because this Czechoslovakian cartoon even got an airing in the UK. Yep, we Brits know this as The Mole, as seen on BBC television right into the 1980s. The game, however, is called Schmetterlinge, which, if I pronounce that right, is German for butterflies. You have to guide the mole to catch butterflies, and those flowers are in your way, and it's... oh, come on. It's a rough modification of that deer hunt game, isn't it? I mean, all the danger's been taken out of it, and it's the most anodyne thing I've played since going through those official Barbie games on the Nintendo Game Boy Advance. Scheißbude is German for shooting gallery, and look, this is another straight-up rip-off of Carnival, that 1980 arcade game released by Sega, which I stumbled across when I visited Black Ball's Play Expo. This, as you can see, isn't quite as good, missing a few features, but it's one of the better games out of the whole Polyplay collection, and marginally does better than the home computer version on East Germany's KC-85. Now, we know Germany is well known for its prowess in car manufacturing and a reputation for motor racing. However, that's not very translated well in this primitive racer. Autorennen, that's motor race to you and I, is like a no-frills super sprint. However, once you get into it, it's not too bad. There's a genuine challenge to it, and it becomes rather enjoyable. Sorry if this sounds like I'm being taken in by a digital version of Stockholm Syndrome, but no, this is well worth a play. I mean, it's no Badlands, and some cynics might say it's a bad Badlands, but stick with it and you'll fall for its secret charm. Merkspiel is a word meaning memory game, and this is, you guessed it, a memory game. I mean, it really does what it says on the tin. It gets trickier and trickier, but I can't say there's any fun in this. I'm not even going to try to pronounce this game's name, but it does translate to Burst Water Pipe. I don't even need to describe how to play it, because just by the on-screen action, you can see what needs to be done. It's kind of like an inverted Space Invaders. It makes me wonder why the authorities let this one through, because it could be said this game is a critique of housing conditions this side of the Berlin Wall. Yeah, gaming satire, that's what we're after. Without a doubt, the Polyplay is my favourite thing in this museum. I just like the unique games that it has. I don't care if they're like the Cascade 50 thing on the ZX Spectrum. There's something really nice about this. I love the decor, like this disco-inspired styling up here. I think every home should have one. So that concludes my visit to the Computerspiel Museum. It's a very interesting take. It's kind of similar to what we have in Cambridge back in the UK, like the Cambridge Centre for Computing History, but this is a refreshing take. It's a very tricky job to try and mix education and gaming into one and still make it fun. And I think these guys have done it. So really, what can I say on this momentous occasion? It's rare I venture outside of the UK. I would say that this is an ode to joy, or maybe an ode to joysticks. Sorry for that awful pun. I've been Pete Brodge. See you next time. Cheers.
And remember, there's always plenty of fun to be had here on the Reheated Pixels channel, filled with retro gaming programs.